Mark opens his gospel with these words, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. But what is that good news that Jesus brought? Coming up on Cross Connection. Welcome to Cross Connection. We are so glad you have joined us. We are excited for a great study because today we begin our study of the life and teachings of Jesus Christ in the Gospel according to Mark.
That's right. It's good to be back, right?
Yes.
And as you said, Oleg, the Gospel of Mark opens with this line, the beginning of the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. But a question that naturally follows that is, why is that good news? So we invite you to get connected through Facebook, Twitter, text, email, anything you can think of, and answer today's Cross Connection question. What about Jesus the Messiah is good news to you?
And I would like to jump right into our set right here, because we have Jillian, Diego, and Martha joining us. And thank you so much for joining us as well. And let me ask you a question that I usually ask. How do you enjoy the weather today? How did you enjoy the weather today?
It was okay.
It was warmer.
It was very.
It was rainy, but it was okay.
Excellent. And I hope you enjoy your weather in whatever part of the world you are in. And also, what our Cross Connection, as you probably know, we are just coming back with the premiere of a new season, and we will be studying the Gospel according to Mark. But before we do that, we want to let you know that we were not just sitting and just waiting when the season will start, because we did something.
That's right. We hope that you watching at home had an eventful holiday. We certainly had an eventful holiday time, and it's actually the subject of today's Jesus Lives, so check it out. All right, Oleg, we're back. It's been a few weeks. What have we been doing while we've been gone?
First of all, Cross Connection never stops.
That's right.
And first of all, we remain in the Word of God, mm-hmm. but we also try to improve our show.
That's right. And so this time we actually improved our show, but we wanted to reach out, mm-hmm. and we went to a conference called Generation of Youth for Christ.
And it's a big gathering where 6,000, maybe even more people mm-hmm. get together in order to glorify Jesus Christ and act in this world.
That's right. And we're all about getting connected. We want to get connected there. So first step was getting our booth set up. That was a little bit unique.
Exactly, because we actually built it ourselves.
Right.
And it took us about 5 days to build it, and maybe even more.
So why did we do that insanity?
Yeah, because first of all, we want to imitate Jesus Christ. And we know that Jesus was a carpenter.
Right.
But the word that is used in the New Testament mm-hmm. is actually tekton.
Tekton.
Tekton, that's right, tectonic plates. Have you heard
okay,
of that?
Okay, yeah, yeah.
So tekton, which means a builder as well. So
okay.
Jesus Christ was a builder.
So we're imitating Jesus Christ
in
everything, even in our booth. But it's a little bit of a cross illusion as well. But that took a lot of time to get started. We actually built it right here where we are now in our studio, and we got that set up, and then we drove all the way down to Orlando and went to the convention.
Yeah, exactly. But it's not just the booth that was impressive, but there was something else, because we prepared a special gift mm-hmm. for everyone who was passing by.
Everyone who swung by. And we're all about getting into the Word, so we thought, how can we get people into the Word in a unique way? So we came up with a photo booth.
So what is it? Like, what was the process?
Well, the process is we have a green screen, very much like we're in front of now, and you would step in front of that. We have, those of you that watch the show know, we have our backdrops that we have, animated backdrops. You could get your picture taken in front of any one of those, so it's like you're in front of the empty tomb, or you're right there at Golgotha, or you're right there by the Sea of Galilee, and we would just send that out to everyone who's stop by for free.
And more than 1,500 people passed by our booth.
At least, yeah.
And we were blessed.
Yeah.
We hope that you were blessed as well if you were there.
Yeah, no, it was an awesome experience. It was really cool getting to meet so many different people. And we really had all kinds of people there. We had young, we had older, we had in between, we had extremely young, little children were there.
By the way, there is a couple who took a 25th anniversary picture right there.
Very cool. So we had families, couples, all kinds of different groups of people, but it was really great to get connected with all kinds of people there. It was a lot of fun.
Most importantly, I was really, really impressed when we saw our Cross Connection viewers
who would
come and who would say how they enjoy the show and how they learn more when they get in contact with us and also with the entire community.
Yeah, and you know, we know that we're blessed when we do these studies, and it's great to actually encounter those of you that are connected to the Word through Cross Connection as well, and it was a really, really great experience. experience, and we got to talk to a few people who kind of let us know what Cross Connection meant to them and the things that they liked about it, and that was really great.
I've been watching it since the first episode that aired.
Wow.
And like, I've seen so much improvement, like from the way, you know, from the beginning to now, yeah. And the creativity, like, you know, from, you know, showing the backgrounds, you know, getting into the you know, the style, into the you know, like, into people's hearts at home, right? What I love is the recent the treasure. When you open, you know, like, you dissect, you know, the scripture and you open it up. Oh, it's amazing. It just, you know, it helps people at home, and it's just so inspiring. Yeah, I love you guys, the way that you guys, like, you have that inspiration and that passion for, you know, Christ. It's beautiful. It's just really touching.
Well, Sergio, it was a lot of fun and it was a great blessing for us.
Yeah.
But what is the greater meaning of us doing that?
Well, the whole reason we do what we do is to get connected. And that was such a great opportunity to get connected with people, both that are a part of our global cross-connection Bible study community and those who are not yet, but maybe were interested in being. And that was so awesome to meet with all of them and get connected. And you feel that passion there when you have thousands upon thousands of young people whose hearts are on fire for Jesus Christ. It is such a powerful experience, and it's that wonderful reminder that yes, Jesus lives, and we just had an awesome time. It was so cool to get connected with those of you that were there in Orlando, those of you that are connecting with us every week on Cross Connection. We want to thank you, invite you to stay connected with us. It was a good time, wasn't it, Oleg?
Absolutely.
It was a really good experience, but now we have New year, new gospel. We have to go into Mark now.
Absolutely. And what I really enjoyed, that Martha and Jillian were actually there as well.
Yeah.
So you got to experience it as well. And you took a picture with your parents there.
No, I made them take it by themselves.
Ah, okay, by themselves. Yeah. Okay.
They needed their own cross-connection experience.
Exactly, exactly. So thank you very much for being a part of that experience as well. And now we are studying the gospel according to Mark. And trust me, if you haven't been blessed previously when we studied the gospel according to John, and I hope you were blessed. Just as we were, yes. And I hope you will be blessed when we will be studying the gospel according to Mark. But not just the gospel according to Mark. Because what is the point of us studying the gospel according to Mark? There is no point if we don't see Jesus there.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Amen.
Because the gospels are about revealing Jesus Christ, the Son of God, Amen. God himself, who dwelt on earth. Mm-hmm. So it's incredible. And if you can get excited about one thing, that should be gospels, just gospels. Mm-hmm. So that's why we are extremely excited. Anyway, before we jump into the gospels, into the gospel according to Mark, let's pray. And Sergio, could you lead us in prayer?
Sure. Father, we want to thank you for your blessings. We want to thank you for the way that you reveal yourself to us through your word. And we just ask that you do that now for us, for everyone studying with us at home, that you reveal yourself to us, that we may come to know you and experience eternal life, which is to know you and the one that you sent, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Okay, so let's just draw a very quickly historical context, which is extremely important because it will help us to understand.
It'll frame everything that we study from here on out.
Exactly, yeah. Just the picture, quick picture. So when we talk about the gospel according to Mark, when approximately do you think it was written? Jesus died in approximately 33 AD,
yeah.
And this was written somewhere between 65 and 70.
65, 70 is what people
65,
say.
70, yeah, 65, 70.
Wasn't it written presumably like as a response to Peter's death?
Excellent, this is a very good point. So Peter just died, and this is a very important point because Peter was actually, Mark was one of the disciples of Peter. Exactly. So now imagine what happens. Peter is dead. Yeah. Mark is the one who was always sitting by Peter and listening to all his stories about Jesus.
Right.
And now he is dead. What is he?
And you can almost, you see the impetus where it's just like, man, everyone's falling away. We originally had a style of spreading this through oral tradition and telling everyone, and now everyone's dying. Peter's been crucified. Everyone's falling away. We need a way to permanently record this for generations to come.
So what do you think Mark does?
Starts writing.
Yeah, starts writing.
The first gospel. Yeah.
And it's interesting also because you everything you're sharing also, Mark is the gospel that has more things about Peter. Almost like every single incident there, it's Peter is involved. It's there's a lot of focus on that. It's great because it's really like reliable eyewitness, somebody who really knew Jesus personally.
First-hand account.
Exactly.
First-hand account. Excellent. So now look what happens next. So we see that it was Peter somewhere 65-70 AD. Mm-hmm. There is something also that is extremely important. What it was written in Rome, most likely.
That's where Peter's base of operations was, right?
Exactly. Is this where Peter died as well?
Yes.
Yes, exactly, because that's why they believe that the church, the Peter's Cathedral,
St. Peter's Basilica,
it's still there.
Yeah. It's still there, so they believe that the tomb is still there. That very tomb is Peter's tomb. Maybe, who knows? But this is what was happening. So it was in Rome. Now, there is something very important, because the first century Christianity in Rome was not very pleasant.
Oh, yeah. Mm.
Why do you
not
say, oh, no? Oh, wow. Why?
Well, definitely there were a lot of issues. First, because there was no Christianity per se. Mm-hmm. It was just a movement,
mm-hmm.
a segment that they came out of from Judaism, and now there are a lot of Gentiles, people from all over the world joining it. So they're not Jews, they're nobody, and there's one law in those days. If you were not a Jew, you were forced to worship the emperor.
Okay, mm-hmm. this is a very interesting point. So if you have to worship an emperor, mm-hmm. and do you remember about any persecution, like persecution, how Christians were persecuted?
Yeah. Even in the Colosseum,
yes.
and how they were a spectacle to the people, how they were being killed. And
so Christians were thrown into the Colosseum to be eaten by
any horrible way you can think of to kill a person, that it was done there.
For fun.
Yeah. Exactly, for spectacle.
Exactly, for fun. And they would eat their bread and just enjoy the... this is just... this is what was happening. This is what is also important, what Diego, you just mentioned, that you all people, no matter... Okay, Romans could care less about whom you worship. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They don't care.
It's very cosmopolitan.
Cosmopolitan
culture,
and polytheistic.
Yeah.
There's many gods.
Many gods. You choose one, pick one, and worship.
Yeah, but why would they be opposing to this idea of Christianity? Because Christians wouldn't want to worship also Caesar.
Definitely.
Because Caesar was the son of God.
Right. Mm-hmm. And it was actually right around the time of Jesus that title was added to the emperor, the ruler Caesar, the son of God. And that's actually right around when Jesus came.
Excellent. So Christians are the ones who are pushed back.
Right. So they have a direct antagonistic response to that. No, he's not the son of God. Jesus is the son of God.
Okay, do you see this framework?
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Do you see this framework? Hope you do. If you don't, just let us know. Or you can rewatch this segment when it's posted on our Facebook, not just Facebook page,
the web
as well.
Page.
Yeah, exactly. So let's start reading the first verse of the Gospel according to Mark, taking that into consideration, what we just talked about. And Julian, could you lead us in?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Okay, there's just two questions right away. They jump at me. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The beginning of the gospel. Mm. What gospel are we talking about? What is gospel anyway?
Good news.
Yeah.
Good news. Yeah. But why did... Okay, in my case it says gospel. What about NIV and some other translations? It says actually good news.
Mm-hmm.
So what is that good news? What is good news in today's world?
No.
Well,
those are very different questions.
It is, yeah. But I think good news, it's something that would surprise you for mm-hmm. better. It's something almost like you could never have imagined by yourself. Mm-hmm. It would totally surprise you. And definitely the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not the gospel of King Herod or another king. It's of Jesus Christ. And this can guarantee will surprise everybody. It's a news that nobody could have expected.
But I think it's important that it's the very first line
in his
gospel. So it's important that everything I read from here on out, everything that we study in Mark, is good news. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think if you're reading it in a way that it's not good news, then you're reading it wrong.
Definitely.
And I think oftentimes we add, it's good news if, it's good news but, or it's maybe possibly. No, this is good news. And I think we need to frame everything we read from here on out that this is good news. What about this is good news?
And this is so incredible because if you even read this term in our Bible, it says gospel.
Mm-hmm.
Gospel. But in Greek it says evangelium or evangelium. Evangelium, evangelium. The word evangelism comes from that word, which means you, like utopia, you is prefix that means good. And angelos means message, just like angels. We call angels messengers.
Yeah.
So good message.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the best message in the world that you can possibly read.
Right. Mm-hmm.
In fact, let me add, because this is just incredible, because Mark pretty much invents this new genre of literature that would be called gospels. Mm. And from now on, this is what we also need to mention quickly, that the gospel according to Mark was most likely the first gospel that was ever written.
It's powerful.
And this is what we will be studying, so I hope you're not sleeping yet. I hope you're just as excited as we are, and that we will continue our discussion of the gospel according to Mark right after the break. So stay with us.
That's right, and don't forget to take the time to answer today's question. What about Jesus the Messiah is good news to you? We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Cross Connection. We just talked about the exciting framework of the gospel according to Mark. Exciting, but at the same time, dramatic and sad.
Very dramatic.
Because people are persecuted. People are thrown into Colosseum to be eaten by wild animals. They're put on fire, literally, when they're alive as torches. In fact, this is this where when Nero blamed Christians?
Yes.
Right. Yeah, Martha, what was happening there?
Well, Nero burned the city, basically, and then he blamed the Christians. He needed somebody to blame. Yeah. And you're the historian.
But you're exactly right.
And especially because a lot of Christians were saying that the world would come an end to it by fire. So he sets fire in Rome, blames on Christians. They already didn't have a very good reputation. So it's perfect scenario to put the blame on them and persecute them.
Excellent. But I think a point that we need to mention, though, about the context is the fact that even though they were being persecuted and even though they were dying so much, a lot of other people were coming too. Like the blood of the ones that were dying were like seeds for others to keep following.
This is so great. And look what happens then. Then Jesus, and then Mark says, the beginning of the good news. In this time of persecution, there is good news.
You see there's hope.
Those times are how similar those times are to our times.
Yeah. Very similar.
Yeah, I mean, imagine nowadays or during World War II, especially today, there is hope. You look around, no matter how bad things look, there's still hope.
Just as many, Jillian, you're involved with worldwide ministry around
with
the globe. ADRA. So, what do you, when you come to different countries, what do you see in those countries? Sometimes.
Well, everything but nothing. And I think that's the thing that's most shocking is that I remember the first experience that I had with it that I think actually got me into the development side of things. I was in Zimbabwe at an AIDS orphanage and these kids, small kids, their heads were all shaved to prevent, you know, bugs and disease. And they sat there and they sang to us, a group of young Americans who could afford to go to South Africa, "Jesus shed his blood for me." And when I go to these countries, I came back from Nepal from Madagascar a couple of weeks ago. There's nothing there. I mean, these kids are dirty. They wear the same, literally wear the same t-shirt all year. But then you go to church and they sing at the top of their lungs. I mean, that to me is the gospel in action. That is the good news. Powerful. They are experiencing it every day.
So how incredible that is. Even just like 2,000 years ago, we see those people who have been persecuted, but then they say, okay, there is a good news. This is my good news. And my good news is the Son of God, Jesus Christ, not another Son of God. Who?
Right. Caesar.
Not Caesar. Right. That Caesar, he can give me bread sometimes when I sit in Colosseum, but nothing else. Yeah. The other one gives me new kingdom.
Powerful.
Exactly. Something that lasts.
Something that lasts. And this is exactly what people experience today as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah, this is just incredible. But let me tell you something, and we need to get into the word right now.
Know it.
Yeah, exactly. So we travel with Jesus Christ all the way to the first century, and what you see behind me is actually the city, the town, the village of Capernaum behind me, and the town of Tiberias behind Sergio. And we will explore it later, so you have to stay with us for about 3 weeks when we get to that point. Yeah, but what we see Jesus when he starts his ministry, going and being baptized right there behind Sergio, somewhere in that region. And we will see what will happen. What is incredible that Mark starts the story about Jesus, but introduces first and foremost John the Baptist. Isn't this amazing?
Yep. The story of Jesus Christ, and then he talks about John the Baptist.
Exactly. Right. The next verse is actually about John the Baptist. So make sure to read the Gospel according to Mark at home. But Hidden Treasure today is prepared specifically about John the Baptist. So check it out. Lighthouses are beautiful to look at. But what's even more beautiful than their form is their function. You see, the light from a lighthouse helps guide you to shore, by letting you know that land is near and you need to be prepared. For someone away at sea for a long time, this is the most welcome sight you could hope for. And that's the subject of today's Hidden Treasure. A lighthouse of sorts is located at the very end of the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi. It says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the hearts of their children to their fathers." Through his prophet Malachi, God let us know that before the great day of the Lord, Elijah would be sent to turn the hearts of the people. What's amazing is that at the very beginning of the Gospel of Mark, we encounter a character that bears a striking similarity to Elijah, John the Baptist. Let's take a closer look together. 2 Kings 1:8 describes Elijah in a very unmistakable way. He had a garment of hair and had a leather belt around his waist. That reads awfully similar to the description of John the Baptist we read in Mark 1:6. Now, John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist. The similarities run more than just skin deep. As we just saw in Malachi, Elijah would come before the day of the Lord to turn the hearts of those he was sent to. Now, Mark tells us that John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. What's important to note here is that the Greek word for repent, metanoeo, literally means to turn around. Mark clearly presents John the Baptist as a second Elijah that prepared people for the day of the Lord and guided them to Jesus Christ. For those of us that have been drifting in the sea of sin and doubt, without direction or purpose, this is the most beautiful thing we could hope to see. John the Baptist is a lighthouse that lets us all know that the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. And that's today's hidden treasure. So when we look at John the Baptist, it's fascinating because the story about John the Baptist is recorded in all four gospels.
Yeah.
What is it?
All four gospels.
All four gospels.
Yeah.
So why do you think the ministry of John the Baptist was so important and so significant for all four evangelists?
Yeah.
Those who present the good news.
Well, one thing that jumped out at me is that we put a lot of emphasis on prophecy. And to me, mentioning that John the Baptist came first shows that all the prophecy was true. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just all of a sudden here's Jesus, but look, as Mark says in verse 2, as it is written in the prophets, like, almost, you know, event for event, the prophecy is all unfolding before us.
This is simply great because, when Jesus comes, so it's not just out of blue sky, just here's the Son of God, bam, here he is. No. Everything leads to him. Everything just points to him. And the entire Old Testament points to him.
No, and you see, it's very cool that John is kind of stirring up this because it's throughout, you know, their culture that they were anticipating a Messiah, and John starts to stir that up. The Messiah's coming. And then Jesus comes, and maybe he's a disappointment to a lot of people expecting the Messiah, but he comes and it is good news. And so it is very important that John did that. But also I think of, I want to be like John, and that John pointed people to Jesus.
Exactly.
He was kind of the proto-Christian. He was a Christian before there was even a Christ, before Christ's mission even started.
Proto-Christian, proto-Christian, the one who is the best Christian of all Christians. Right. Proto-Christian.
The one that came before any other Christians.
Exactly.
So I want to be like John the Baptist in that sense, and pointing people to Jesus and say, look, this is good news. The good news is here. It has arrived.
Please.
No, I was just saying, I think given the time that John had with the people, he built a relationship with them. Mm-hmm. And it's that trust thing. So, okay, well, if John's saying this guy's legit, I guess I should give it a chance.
And it happened with the disciples, because that's what Peter and his brother and the other ones, they were disciples of John. Mm-hmm. And then they went, like John just said, go follow him.
Yeah. Right.
And you remember what we read in the Gospel according to John, actually, because this is fascinating, because in the Gospel according to John, it's clearly presented. So this is amazing, because what we see also here is the fact that John the Baptist, he was in the wilderness, but all people were coming to him in the wilderness. And now when Jesus comes and Jesus goes out and everybody, and then Jesus comes into different villages and he recruits. Mm-hmm. Others. Yeah. So, in fact, Josephus, one of the historians, he says that the following of John the Baptist was extremely magnificent. It was extremely huge. Yeah,
and he has to be very different from all the others, because there were other preachers talking about apocalyptic coming, or
the end of days
is coming, whatever. So there was something really special about John the Baptist. What we know is the Spirit.
And I like what Sergio said. He pointed to Jesus. This is what's extremely special about him. He says, behold, the Lamb of God.
Right.
Here he is.
Right.
He is the one who will baptize you in spirit, and we will find out more about it. But let's move forward. So we learned about John the Baptist. If we go forward, then we see that there is something incredible happens when Jesus comes and there is being baptized in Mark chapter 1 verse 11. So Jesus is being baptized, and what do we read in John chapter 1, verse 11? Martha, could you read for us?
Yes. Then a voice came from heaven. You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.
So who says these words?
God.
God
himself.
Yeah, the parts of God.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. God himself, he says, wow, this is my Son. Mm-hmm. Imagine what could have happened to like the crowd if they heard it, or John the Baptist. And look, imagine what happens in the minds of the readers and listeners when they hear these words.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In their understanding, there is one Son of God. That's the Son of God sits on the throne.
Yeah.
He's the Caesar.
Caesar. Now you hear God himself say, no, this is my Son. This is the Son of God.
So how does the picture of identity of God changes, of Jesus Christ changes?
It changes dramatically. It's really like a paradigm shift for everyone. They knew, they believe, or they have to respect the Caesar anyways, but now you see this man coming into this Jordan River, which was very relevant for them. It was where the people crossed it, where God made miracles also. And now, this is the one. It's not this guy sitting on his throne. It's this guy here. He might look humble, but wait a minute, I'm going to show you that he is my Son. And in a sense, in a Jewish culture, Son is equal to the Father. So he's given the full authority and power to Jesus Christ.
Yeah, and what can we learn about like the fact that Jesus is the true Son of God? Because today we also have things that we call sons of God with small s.
Right.
This is my Son of God, etc. This is what kind of my God, little with g, small g.
Mm-hmm. Right.
How many of those gods do we have?
Oof. I mean, we all have it, and it's different for all of us. Mm-hmm. But you know, when you think of, to pick on Caesar, what did Caesar represent? Caesar represented quite literally God and country. He represented authoritarian power. He represented the greatness of Rome. He represented scientific and cultural advancement.
Or money.
To some people. Yeah,
money.
He represented power. Power of any and every kind.
Because even the coin bore his witness.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
His image, sorry. His image.
And Jesus comes and says, that is all a lie. You are not going to find anything there. This is the Son of God. Come and follow me. This is what it's all about. And he brings, as Diego alluded to, a new kingdom, a new kingdom to follow.
And let's read the following Mark chapter 1, verse 15. Verse 15. And Sergio, could you read for us verse 15?
Yes. And saying, the time is fulfilled.
But now it's Jesus. Jesus is saying something.
These are red letters, yes.
14 and 15. Let's just read 14.
14, okay. Yes. Now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.
Wow.
So look how significant that is. We talked about the kingdom of God that Jesus brings. Mm-hmm. So now we see, look at this progression. John the Baptist is preaching, repent, because the kingdom of God is at hand. Mm-hmm. Here Jesus comes and he says, he's been baptized, and now he says, the kingdom of God has arrived.
It's here.
Wow. It's here. It's right here. Now, repent and believe the gospel.
Yes.
Believe the good news. Now, the place where Jesus was being baptized, and I would like us to see that place on the map, in the map of Israel. So if you look at the map of Israel, and when we see the place where Jesus was baptized, you see right across it, there is Jericho. Jericho. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You see that little red dot?
Yeah. Yeah.
So right across the Jericho. Jericho was the town where the Israelites, when they crossed,
crossed over the river after wandering, escaping.
Exactly. For how many years?
40.
40 years they were wandering around, and this is where they crossed the river. And this is exactly the place, in addition to that, where John the Baptist is baptizing people. And now look what happens here. The kingdom is coming. This new kingdom is coming. That new revelation, that new promised land is nearing us in Jesus Christ. And that's why Jesus says, follow me. You will be excited. I hope you're excited just as we are. And you will be, we will be amazed what we will discover next. We will continue studying the Word of God. So stay with us.
That's right. And don't forget to jump into this conversation with answering today's Cross Connection question. What about Jesus the Messiah is good news to you?
Welcome back. The study of the Word of God sets our hearts on fire.
Amen.
And if you feel the same, don't keep it to yourself. Share your thoughts and your comments, and your comment will be read right here.
That's right. I'll read a couple right now, actually. We have a comment from Daniel, just says, "What good news for the entire universe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Redeemer of the lost. Greetings from Puerto Rico." Thank you, Daniel. But, you know, it again leads to our question, what about Jesus is good news? And I think Eddie Bukola has a really cool answer. It says, "There's more to life than the bad news that happens every day, like crime, sickness, poverty. But we have a way out. And the way out is to a life much, much better." Welcome back, Cross Connection. So thank you very much. And I think we're going to start to explore it. We see that Jesus is tempted. He's about to be tempted and face some trials. Mark is writing to people that are being persecuted, that are going through really hard times. But what about this good news is keeping them going through that whole thing?
And this is a very important point, because when we see that Jesus has been just baptized, we read about his baptism, at the very place where the Jewish nation crossed the River Jordan.
So symbolic.
It is symbolic.
Very, yeah.
And do you think it's just symbolic just for the sake of symbolism?
Because
there is a great point in that. Yeah, and look how that happens. So he crosses the river, and he's been and he calls everybody to follow him, enter this promised land, enter this kingdom, new kingdom that I'm about to give.
Cross over with him.
Yeah, cross over with him. This is beautiful.
And we can even talk about the walls falling of Jericho and how the power of God is evidenced as the walls have been. Like, it was all the power of God. Just
this is great.
The men didn't do anything. They didn't fight. It was God fighting for them. Yeah. And here Jesus came to fight the evil for them.
Mm-hmm. It's God
again. Exactly.
Destroying the spiritual walls of darkness in the world.
This is so great, because
good.
That is exactly why in Mark chapter 1, later on, we will see how those spirits, those evil spirits, are cast out.
Yes. Yeah.
The walls are broken. The walls are broken. Everything is gone. Now the new kingdom is established.
Right, and we're able to see that they're still going to be, you're still going to face tough times. Yes. Jesus didn't come to make life easy. That's not why he came. But he came, what he accomplished was that he overcame the world. And I think of the gospel we just studied, John, in John 16:33, where he says, "I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart, because I have overcome the world." Wow. And that is what we see in Jesus Christ. So people, even as they're suffering, even as they're being persecuted, they know that Jesus has overcome the world, and they can still take heart throughout all those
tough times. Great. And let's take just take one step back to our context. Imagine this community of believers who are being persecuted, and they're reading these words, and they say, okay, so this is the gospel, the good news about Jesus Christ. Jesus has been baptized. We understand that, because we were just baptized. But now, what about our life? We are still being persecuted. We are still being tempted. We are still we are still suffering. Julian, take us to Mark chapter 1, verses 12 and 13.
Okay.
What do we read about Jesus here?
Well, it's very short in Mark's very fast fashion. Anyways, verse 12. "Immediately the Spirit drove him into the wilderness, and he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him."
Mm. Wow. Is it similar to Christian walk?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, Julian, how?
So similar.
Why?
Well, I think, as Sergio said, just because you're baptized doesn't mean that it's all sunshine and cupcakes.
Right.
There are going to be trials. And I think the closer that you're drawing towards Jesus, the more Satan tries to push back and say, no, 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 don't do that. Don't do that. Yeah. And I think, I'm sorry if I'm talking too much, but I think with this one, what I really like about this is that Jesus was Son of God, but he was also Son of Man. So he was not beyond the reach of what we encounter on a regular basis with the temptation, with the trials, but he proved that we could get through it.
Still, and I think it's a powerful part here, because it's in the wilderness. And how many of us in our lives have been our wildernesses, right? That you're going through trials, and sometimes you try to find help from everybody else. You seem to be alone.
Yes.
But the Bible has actually said, no, there's someone else who walked this wilderness before you. It's Jesus. He's right there with you.
But not just the wilderness, but also wild animals are attacking you from anywhere.
Right.
So
just like the Christians being persecuted in his day.
Exactly. Yeah. So you're a Christian in this wilderness by yourself, and not just that. There are animals around you who want to attack you. Those spirits or whatever it can be, your enemies who are persecuting you, etc., etc. And then it says at the very end of this passage that you just read,
the angels ministered to him.
Wow. It's comforting.
Yeah. Yes.
But even there is this good news.
No, and yeah. You really do see comfort there, because I think a lot of times we get a little spoiled in our 21st century Western world. We wonder, I'm going through this tough time. Why is God letting me go through this tough time? Why isn't God applying Novocaine to my life and not allowing me why is he allowing me to suffer? But how powerful is it, like you said, Diego, mm-hmm. that he didn't come to just make the world all nice and rosy. He actually experienced those troubles too. Mm-hmm. He came down to our level. And before any of us experienced anything tough in our life, Jesus experienced it. And he was tempted. Exactly. And he was around the wild animals. Mm-hmm. He even needed to be ministered to. And it's very powerful to know that Jesus went through even worse what we're going through.
He can relate to us.
Yes, mm-hmm. exactly. Yeah, it binds us to him.
The verse that comes to mind for me is 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13.
Okay, so 1 Corinthians 10,
verse 13. And it's been my favorite verse for years. But it reads, "No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow mm-hmm. you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it."
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And this to me, great. The proof of that is Jesus mm-hmm. surviving his time in the wilderness.
It's so amazing that not only does he get us out of it and make sure that we will never experience too much, mm-hmm. he even goes, I know how you feel. I know what you're going through. I went through that too. And it's just so, he makes him so relatable.
It's so much more compelling.
Yeah.
And it even takes us all the way back to Adam, where Adam failed. Jesus succeeded.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And that's why later we will read that in the writings of Paul. He's our second Adam. Yeah.
Right. And we see here in Mark, where he overcomes Satan, and then what does he start doing very little bit later? He starts casting out unclean spirits. Yes. Yeah. He has a victory over Satan, and then now he's going out and he's wiping out evil left and right wherever he encounters.
And the other thing too, he's the Adam, but also look, Israel, right before they came out of Egypt, they crossed what? The Red Sea. Right? Mm-hmm. Now they're in the wilderness and they failed. That's the reason why they had to be mm-hmm. wandering around for 40 years. Mm-hmm. Now Jesus is baptized in the Jordan River, still water. He comes to the wilderness
but
he does not
succeeded.
Fail. So he's Amen. Succeeded. He Amen. Wins through for Adam, he wins for us. Whether we would fail, he wins for us.
All of us. He is the victory, the ultimate victory. And in him, we are also victors.
Powerful.
Because we are his children.
And that's good news.
Praise. And this is a great
really good news.
Exactly. Look what happens there. Then Jesus starts preaching. And when we can read about it in verse 15.
15.
Yeah, 15. And Martha, could you read for us verse 15?
Yes. And saying, "The time is fulfilled, that and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel."
So can you see this progression of mm-hmm. four items? First, the time is fulfilled. Mm. Second item.
The
kingdom of God is at hand. Mm-hmm. Third.
Repent and believe
the gospel. Mm.
And all of those, we can see them fulfilled in chapter one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because the time is fulfilled, Jesus has come, mm-hmm. the kingdom of God has arrived in Jesus Christ. Look what happens. Repent, turn around.
Yeah.
What is the following verse? What is the following story, Sergio?
He calls his disciples.
Yes.
Yeah.
Who calls them from where?
They're fishermen.
Mm-hmm. So what is the meaning of the word repent? We learned about it.
Turn around.
So they were in their boats. Mm-hmm. Now, what do you need to do?
Turn around.
Turn your boat around.
Turn your boat, follow Jesus.
Yeah, mm-hmm. that's powerful.
You wherever you are, it's not that easy.
No, but you know, it's interesting to go back to verse 15 where he says, believe in the gospel. We sometimes think gospel, we use it like, that's the gospel truth. You need to believe what this is. It's gospel truth. But gospel's good news. Mm-hmm. It's an interesting say to believe in the good news, you know. But it's something I know I've experienced in my life where I had years where I was questioning and doubting and wandering around, not knowing exactly how I thought about Jesus and God. The toughest thing for me coming back was that it really was as good news as what it was. Yeah. You know, that's the toughest, that God really is that good, that he really is that love, that he really loves me that much. Sometimes that's the hardest thing to believe, that how good, the news is so good that sometimes he has to say, believe in it. You got to believe it. This news really is that good.
It's not just a fairy tale, because sometimes, especially in our skeptical mind, like society, is wait a second, I always apply my reasoning.
Right.
And according to my reasoning, it cannot be that good. What are you talking about? Like, everything is bad.
Right.
Yeah. And here Jesus says, trust me, it will get even better verse after verse, chapter after chapter, encounter after encounter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You will see something incredible happening.
I so relate to this, especially what Sergio was saying, that even when I was an atheist, you know, Jesus is not only saying turn around, but he's pointing a new way,
yes,
believing the gospel. Because yes, one thing you can be, I was turning around to different many ways and paths, trying to find here and there. I could not find my way. But Jesus not only saying turn around, but say here's the way.
So
pointing to the gospel. Yes.
Turn around and follow me.
Exactly. And it's real, and you'll experience it, and it'll have a powerful impact on your life. I want to take an email that we got from Julia, actually, that talks about this very thing. This is Julia from New Jersey. Says, Jesus the Messiah turned my life around, exactly like we're discovering. It says, the first time I experienced Jesus, I was left speechless. He is real. Mm-hmm. Jesus lives. There's power in prayer. We serve an omnipotent, omniscient, and mighty God. So thank you for your comment. That's very powerful. That really, this good news can be experienced, and it is real. We don't have to just talk about it in an intellectual sense.
And this is so great. And this is what I like about the Gospel according to Mark. And while we dive deeper and deeper in the Gospel according to Mark, you will be just as amazed just as us. And make sure to read the Gospel according to Mark at home. Sergio, is that right?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting, like, I don't have the training you have in all of the biblical studies, but a training I did get in college was I took poetry classes. And weirdly, those are the classes that applied to my study of the Gospels the most. Because poetry professors always tell you, when you read a poem, you can't just read it once and understand the meaning.
Mm-hmm. No.
You have to read it, you have to read it again, and again, and again. And it's only about the sixth or seventh reading that you get a sense of, okay, my brain has soaked it up. Mm-hmm. I know what this is about. So I encourage you watching at home, read Mark not once, not twice, but a few times. And that's when you really start to get the meaning.
And it's a short Gospel, so you so you won't spend a lot of time. It's 45 minutes and you will be done with it. One set of reading. And don't go anywhere, because right after the break we will dive deep and we will see how to experience this good news and how we can experience it as well.
That's right, Cross Connectors. Let's get connected with today's question. What about Jesus the Messiah is good news to you? See you soon.
Welcome back. We are discussing the Gospel according to Mark. And so what we saw a beautiful picture emerge when we see Jesus, first of all, the Mark proclaiming that this is the good news about Jesus Christ,
the Son of God.
Not Caesar, but Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Then we see John the Baptist, who is shouting, repent, the kingdom of heaven is just coming near. And then in Jesus Christ, we see how Jesus enters this kingdom, blazes this trail, and he leads the way to this kingdom of God. And he says, follow me, to his disciples, follow me, and you will experience this good news. And now we come to the point when we will actually experience that good news.
And as we talk about it, can I take a couple of comments?
Sure, absolutely.
On this, please? Nancy has a text message. I'll take this one. It says, knowing that Jesus has given me and all who believe in him eternal life, it gives me great comfort and peace to know that he will be with me through all my troubles. I like that. Won't get rid of all my troubles, but will be with me through all my troubles. I love that. He loves us so much, and he sent his spirit to comfort us. Welcome back. Thank you, Nancy. And I'll now lead into a question, because it's about what we're going to go into. Peter asks, why does Mark use the word immediately so often in chapter 1 to show Jesus as a man of action having dominion over the physical and spiritual worlds?
I think you answered that question very well.
Yes and yes.
And we will discover it even more.
But we see Jesus' dominion over the spiritual world, and that he has conquered Satan, and now he's casting out demons.
And we also can take into consideration that Mark was writing in the first century, and it was also dramatical events that took place, and also it's like a theater. Think about it. It's like action, action, action. Julian,
it's very action-oriented.
Why so?
Why do you think he's action-oriented?
The Gospel of Mark.
I don't know. I feel like Mark is just like, guys, this is the point. This is what happened. Yeah. Boom, boom, boom. Enough of this nonsense. Focus.
And look how many verbs. You remember you told us before,
like every other word's a verb.
Action verbs. Yeah. I think he uses the word immediately. I think I read 39 times is in the Gospel of Mark. And I like what you said this, Oleg, and you haven't mentioned it yet, so I have to quote you.
Please.
In that the Gospel of Mark is like a play, and that it has three acts.
Yes.
And it is split up into these three sections. Yeah. And so everything we see is like a scene. It's less long pontificating teachings, and it's just Jesus always doing things. And then he did this, and then he did this, and then he did that.
And this is how the gospel, the good news, is manifested.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we see it alive.
Exactly. It's making a case.
Yeah, I think that the other part also that a lot of people could not read. a lot, mm-hmm. so few people could read. So when they will receive the copies of the Gospels, they probably get together and somebody could read.
Yes.
You read them now with this language that was prepared for them to get engaged.
They could remember
stories. Everything. It was a whole...
Yeah, so oral tradition. It was predominantly oral tradition, and this is what we see. We see this oral transmission
manifested.
Excellent. So let's go and let's see how on the pages of the first chapter we see how this kingdom of God and the gospel, the good news of that kingdom of God, is manifested. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And let's read verses 21 through 25. And I'm sorry, but we'll have to read this entire passage. Mm-hmm. Okay. Julian, could you lead us in these passages?
Verse 21, then they went into Capernaum, and immediately, on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Shall I continue?
Yes.
Now there was a man in their synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him."
Excellent. And the next verse says that he came out.
Yep.
And I love how the man, he's in the synagogue, and he was probably known by the people, so he was like an outcast. Mm-hmm. I don't think he was in the synagogue because he was coming to worship. I think he was coming to seek Jesus. Like, he needed help. He was probably so hopeless and so, like, he was dealing with this demon possession for so many years that he was looking for Jesus, for hope, for good news.
Yes. Yeah.
But this is a very good point. But what if he was in the synagogue because we have demons in our synagogues?
Mm-hmm. True. Yeah.
Because they're there being antagonizing. Yeah, what if throwing the doubt in the questions.
Yeah. Exactly. What if I am a Christian and I don't think that I have my demons, but in fact I do? And I need Jesus in my life. Yeah,
I think this is the whole point to not just because you were namely a Christian, it does not make you immune to the devil. Just say, okay.
So true. Mm-hmm.
It is, you can go to the church and have the devil sitting right next to you in your mind, in your heart.
Yes.
And that reveals a lot about human heart.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so, the Pharisees, they had evils and demons and tough, and they were the leaders of the church, but they were filled with the same spirit as this man.
Because no one is immune to this evil.
Right.
In fact, this is fascinating because those spirits, they say in verse 24, "Did you come to destroy us?"
Yes. And I love that, Ola, because there's not a battle. There's not that they see Jesus and they go, "All right, fellas, here he comes, let's battle." They immediately admit defeat upon seeing him. Jesus is so powerful that even immediately upon seeing him, that they immediately admit defeat. Exactly, and I think that's so powerful. Any demon I have in my life, anything that I'm struggling with, anything that I can't get over, I just imagine that problem looking at Jesus coming and just going running. You know, that my problem is looking at Jesus and going, "Oh boy, Jesus is here," and then it's done. It's all over with.
And this is what happens immediately.
Yes.
In the heart of every believer.
Yeah.
Once you let Jesus in, the other soldier, evil soldier, will have to run out.
Not even a battle. All it is a marathon sprint away.
Exactly.
There's no battle. They just go running.
Exactly. Yeah. Because there is no way that two of them will coexist.
Mm-hmm.
So there is something also incredible, because what we see here that they immediately say that, okay, we know who you are.
I know. Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Why is it awesome?
Because they're the demons and they're proclaiming.
Yeah.
They're saying, "You are," and it's very similar to before, like God was saying, "You're the Son of God." Here they're saying, "You're the Holy One of God."
Mm-hmm.
Like they know that he came from heaven and that he is God. And
so they elevate Jesus even higher. It's like, "Oh, you are the Holy One of God himself."
Well, in Mark, I mean, aside from John the Baptist, they're the first ones to recognize him for who he is.
Mm,
and I think it's pretty consistent that they're the ones that never doubt who he is.
True.
It's always, "You are the Son of God. You are Jesus. We're gone."
They know who he is and they know who they are.
Right.
They're out.
It's so amazing that, you know, if you're not sure if Jesus is the right way, if you're not sure that going to Jesus will work, your problems know that Jesus is the answer.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The more uncomfortable you start to get,
this is
a bit of indication.
This is so important for us to understand that we, even if demons know what the power of God is.
And they tremble.
And they tremble and they run away.
Yes.
How much more do we need to know and do we need to understand that Jesus is the solution to everything?
Yes.
Well, it makes me wonder, I think it's off topic, but it makes me wonder who's really standing in the way of that happening.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
If the demons are ready to say, you are the one who can kick us out, then
who is
what's standing in the way now?
Okay, what or who? And who knows, maybe it's you, maybe it's us, maybe it's you, maybe it's me, maybe it's yourself, we ourselves stay on this way. And because we have our own Caesars, our own sons of God, that we would like to worship. Now,
one thing I think is very interesting, because the very first miracle per se here is a miracle, is casting out demons. Jesus is not even touching people, healing people yet here. So I think he's showing also the bigger picture that his kingdom, it's here on earth, it's coming on earth, but also is destroying the principalities, the devil. And it's not only, he's coming to, he's bringing a revolution to everything, all the worlds.
And this is very important point, because if we look at the all the way to the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis, we see that the entire story of God is always God trying to destroy evil on earth. And the final solution of all solutions is the coming of Jesus Christ to destroy completely, fully. And then the final revelation when Jesus is coming again, it will be the annunciation of the kingdom complete.
Yes. Okay. Can I take a couple of viewer comments? We're talking about good news. I want some other people's perspective on what that means. Marlon on Facebook says, the fact that he is God and that he loves us so much and has given his life for us. The good news is that he is pouring out heaven's resources to save us even now. And one day he will deliver us from this world. Another comment from Facebook I'll take from Helen. Helen says, great news. Jesus' amazing love makes me a better person and gives me a new life. Amazing grace. It surprises me every single day. And I'll take one last comment from Lawrence on Facebook that is just extremely powerful. It says, beautiful. It took time for me to fully understand it, but I understand it now, and I believe in the good news of the gospel of Jesus. So amen, Lawrence. We're praising God. Amen. And it really is amazing how the word of God reveals itself to us in powerful ways.
Praise God. I think it's been a great study, and to be honest, I'm sad because it's almost over. And it's been so short.
Yeah.
Maybe, hopefully you think just as we think. It was very short. Hopefully you were not tired over this hour. But what is your takeaway lesson? We only have about 2 minutes left, so what is your takeaway lesson?
There's good news in everything. I think a lot of the times I can read this and be like, okay, it's a story. Let me get to the something that speaks to me more. But if you really look at it, like Sergio said, read it, reread it, digest it. There's good news in everything.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Yeah. Excellent.
For me, the take home point is coming from John the Baptist. First, his life was all about Jesus. I mean, he was not self-centered. He was just pointing to Jesus in a world that everybody could not see hope. They've lost hope. The power of one. This man believed and accepted and pointed to Jesus. This was powerful to me.
This is
so
great. This is great.
My takeaway lesson is about how Jesus has overcome, like he overcome the devil and he already won. And he can, that victory can be ours every day too. If I have temptations, if I have problems, like he has the power to deal with it and take it all away.
Excellent.
To me, the takeaway is this new kingdom that Jesus came to bring. He didn't come to pluck me out of this world and all the darkness. He came to give a new kingdom that transcends this world, that no matter what I'm going through in this world, I can still have joy. If I'm like the disciples, I can be in prison and still be singing and rejoicing because I have something that you cannot take away from me because it is not of this world and it's powerful to me.
Yeah, this is so great. And I hope, I really enjoyed this study, and I hope you also did enjoy this study. And make sure to read the Gospel According to Mark before our next study, and be prepared because we will be continuing the study of the Gospel according to Mark. Mark opens his gospel with a clear message. The true Son of God is Jesus Christ, and his coming is truly amazing good news. The Son of God not only walked this earth, but he brought down a new, much better type of kingdom. From now on, everyone can turn around and experience the joy of God's kingdom. Jesus calls you to turn away from your personal agendas and back to him as your God, away from your demons, all the way to him. Until next week, stay connected with Jesus Christ in your everyday life and also on Cross Connection.